Welcome to Lighthouse Baptist Church. We're glad you're here this morning. Let's stand together. Turn to hymnals, page 347. Page 347, When the Battle's Over. Page 347, When the Battle's Over. Am I a soldier of the cross or follower of the Lamb? And shall I fear to own his cause or blush to speak his name? And when the battle's over, we shall wear a crown. Yes, we shall wear a crown. Yes, we shall wear a crown. And when the battle's over, we shall wear a crown in the New Jerusalem. Wear a crown, wear a crown, wear a bright and shining crown. And when the battle's over, we shall wear a crown in the New Jerusalem. Must I be carried to the skies on flowery beds of ease, while others fought to win the prize and sailed through bloody seas? And when the battle's over, we shall wear a crown. Yes, we shall wear a crown. Yes, we shall wear a crown. And when the battle's over, we shall wear a crown in the New Jerusalem. Wear a crown, wear a crown, wear a bright and shining crown. And when the battle's over, we shall wear a crown in the New Jerusalem. Sure, I must fight if I would win. Increase my courage, Lord. I'll bear the toil, endure the pain, supported by thy word. And when the battle's over, we shall wear a crown. Yes, we shall wear a crown. Yes, we shall wear a crown. And when the battle's over, we shall wear a crown in the New Jerusalem. Wear a crown, wear a crown, wear a bright and shining crown. And when the battle's over, we shall wear a crown in the New Jerusalem. Let's open with prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we're looking forward to that day when we can be in that New Jerusalem and worship you and throw the crowns that we've earned, throw them at your feet. Lord, I'm looking forward to that day and to get out of this old sinful world and to be in your presence. Lord, I just ask as we're here this morning in church that Lord, our hearts would be ready to hear the word of God, that they would be ready to sing and lift praises to you. Just be with us this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's turn to page 114. Page 114, Tell It to Jesus. Page 114.
A friend or brother, tell it to Jesus alone. Do the tears flow down your cheeks unbidden? Tell it to Jesus, tell it to Jesus. Have your sins that to men eyes are hidden? Tell it to Jesus alone. Tell it to Jesus, tell it to Jesus. A friend that's well known. You've no other such a friend or brother. Tell it to Jesus alone.
On the last.
Are you troubled at the thought of dying. Hail it to Jesus, hail it to Jesus, for Christ's coming kingdom are you sighing. Hail it to Jesus alone, hail it to Jesus, hail it to Jesus, he is a friend that's well known.
Great singing. You may be seated.
Praise the Lord. Good morning. How's everybody doing today? Doing well? Amen. We have had a very, very good week, a very good summer, but it looks like, according to the future weather, what I'm seeing, we're going to start entering into fall. Anybody look at the future weather here? It's like temperatures going down this week. You know, going down to the 60s and low 70s and stuff. That's when I start going into a depression for about 6 months. So, but hey, praise the Lord, we had a really good summer. Certainly thank everybody that was able to come out to our fellowship yesterday. That was a blessing. Had a good time and stuff. So thank you so much for sharing that with us. If you couldn't, hopefully before the end of the year, we'll be able to do something. Amen. Do something else, but praise the Lord for that. I have a few announcements for you. First of all, we had the Pridgen family with us this last Wednesday. If you missed our Wednesday evening service, we had a really good time. The Brother Pridgen preached for us, as well as talked about his mission work to Uganda, and what a great work that they're doing over there. Really good work. They've been there, I think he said again, 25 years of ministry, I think it was. So praise God. Good to see faithful missionaries doing the work of the Lord, and it was a really good service. So continue to pray for them. Their prayer cards are in the back on the prayer table as well, so keep that in your prayers. Let's see. Also, we're into the month of September, and our theme for this month is praying, having the power to pray through fear. So we need to start doing that. Amen. There is a lot of fears. I tell you, I preached a message not too long ago. Well, I always say not too long ago, but could have been 5 years ago with that. But it was about fear and how many phobias and fears that are out there are just ridiculous. There's actually a fear about fear. Amen. And it's crazy. Amen. And I think I even, on one of my fact things, there was a fear about long words. And the word for that is like 15 letters. You know, it's crazy. So. But that goes to show you that there is a lot of fear out there, and we need to pray. Amen. If you have God, the main thing we should fear is God. Amen. But other than that, there shouldn't be much more to fear. Amen. So we really need to pray for all those. There's a lot of people going through a lot of fears, especially what's going on with the COVID thing and people out of work and, you know, the society that we're living in with all the violence and everything. So there's a lot of things to pray and help people to pray. So let's do that for this month. All right. Also, as far as our roof fund, it looks like we're going to go ahead with as far as the company that we've chosen already. I'm meeting with the bank this week, too. I know some people have been giving already. Praise the Lord for that. Whatever you can give, I really mean that. Really, we need it. Amen. Need a big help. So if you can give towards this roof fund as much as you can, believe me, it would be a big help and a blessing. Let's see. School has already started. So I should say started, kind of, in some ways. Amen. Some people are not going at all, but at home virtually. Some are doing both and different things. So pray for all the young ones, you know, as they're out there and going to school, that everybody be safe and the health problems won't bring that stuff home and stuff, especially those that may have health issues. So keep all that in prayer for the families involved. Continue to pray for Brother Skipper. He's an evangelist that got the COVID really bad. He's been in the hospital for about a month. I just received an update yesterday or the day before about him, but is doing better, hoping to get home here in the near future. He's just dealing with certain levels with oxygen and different things like that. So continue to pray for him. Let's see. What else do we have here? I think that's the main things. But pray for those in our church that are going through health issues, you know, that do have health issues, for Sister Sue that's been, you know, up and down with her health issues, and Brother Milt, pray for the cancer to go completely gone from his body. He's getting a screening here shortly. So a lot of different people that are just struggling, businesses as well. We got some business owners in our church where the businesses have really kind of taken a hit during all of this, so keep those in prayer as well. And I think that's my main announcements that I do have, I think. Amen. This week, if we can get some guys to help out, I'm looking to possibly do some work on the front of the church as far as the concrete for our handicap entrance. We got to get that set up and everything, but we got to pour a concrete pad there first, which isn't a main deal. It's just working, getting some things done. We've been really busy. A lot of people have been busy with their own houses and stuff this year as well. I certainly have, and others. But we got to get that done here really quick before the weather really starts turning. Amen. And get to this roof for the two big things for our year. Amen. All right. I think we are good as far as that goes. I pray everybody's been enjoying their summer, you know, the much as possible, the most craziest year we've had in my life as far as society goes. But we got to pray for the peace of our country, pray for the elections coming up, that God's will rule and reign, and we can just do what we can to go forward and bring some unity. Amen. That's what we definitely need in our country right now. Amen. All right. I think that's about all I have. Brother Dennis, come on up.
All right, let's stand together. Turn our hymnals, page number 65. Page 65, Near the Cross. Page number 65, Near the Cross.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There's a precious fountain free to all, a healing stream flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross,
last song this morning, page number 42. Page 42, Saved by the Blood. Page number 42, Saved by the Blood. We'll sing the first, second, and last stanzas.
Saved by the blood of the crucified one, now ransomed from sin and new work begun. Sing praise to the Father and praise to the Son. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. Sing, sing, my sin.
Have been waiting patiently up front. Appreciate that. Let's bow for a word of prayer for the offering. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for the opportunity to give. Lord, thank you for this church. And Lord, I just ask that as a church, as believers in this location, Lord, that you would urge us, encourage us to give like we ought to give. Lord, our tithes, our offerings, our missions. Lord, we want to continue this work, and we're thanking for our pastor that's remain faithful over the years, and Lord, help us to remain faithful as well. Thank you for what you're going to do in Jesus' name. Amen.
get so caught up in listening to the message and the special and stuff, so I forget to put my mic on. All right, there we go. All right, I think we're all set. Well, praise the Lord. That was a blessing. Amen. There is no better friend than Jesus, that's for sure. Psalm 138. Psalm 138. And as you turn in there, I got a couple facts for you. You can hire a clown in Switzerland to stalk your kids and creepily smash a cake into their face on their birthday. It's a true story. If nice clowns weren't terrifying enough, right? Also, President Coolidge, which was our 30th president, he had like a childish sense of humor. They said that he would push the emergency button in his office and then hide when Secret Service came in after him. I bet that upset a few people. And then this is one that I can see a couple people I know doing, but you know how some people are like really cheap? This is one. In 2012, a man wore 60 shirts and 9 pairs of jeans on an 11 and a half hour flight from China to Africa because he didn't want to pay the extra baggage fees. That's being pretty cheap and very uncomfortable doing it. All right. Psalm 138. We'll jump right into it here today. And I really do, you know, every time we come to church, I really believe that something ought to be different when we leave. Amen. Hopefully better by far. And it's just like all of us, we get caught up in our lives. We get so busy and we experience all the different things in our life that each individual does, that sometimes one person can be going through a very difficult, trying time. Another person can be going through a very good time in their life, and things are very good and victorious on one side, could be very just hard and tough and trying on another. Some people are just going through just regular standard things that we deal with in life. And that can happen to everybody differently at all times that we go through life. You know, and certainly as a pastor, you know, I get to know more about people's lives than, you know, probably ordinarily people do. But at the same time, you know, I know that maybe this person's struggling, this person's really doing good and encouraged, this person needs something, and another person needs something completely different. And I've, you know, I remember as a young pastor, you know, struggling, like, how do you help people just in a few messages a week to help them in their areas that they need when people are so different, you know? But of course, I found out pretty early on, it's really the Lord. The Lord does works in people's lives. You can have one message that does 5 different things for 5 different people, you know? And I've learned that certainly early on. But I also know that there's a responsibility for each one of us as individuals of whether we're going to seek out the Lord, or if we're going to try and better ourselves or improve our relationship with him. And that's beside what other influence we have in our own lives. It's just like as a pastor, I'm here to help influence you to do better for the Lord and to learn more about him. But if you don't take what I give, that's on you. Amen. You know, and you know, it's just like people walked away from God. You know, Jesus, when he was a preacher and got all offended, didn't like what he said, and they were in the wrong, you know. But at the same time, you can have very good people around you all the time, but it really comes down to, what are you going to do with it? Are you going to take advice or you're not, you know? And could you just adjust my, I don't know if it's volume or something, but I want you to think a little bit about, where are you at right now? I know I've mentioned that probably at least a couple times over the last number of months, but where are you at spiritually? Where are you at with your relationship with God? And how are you as a Christian? And I want you to just think about that as we get into this message. Now, we're going to pick it up here in Psalm 138. And this is a psalm of David. And he, you know, David certainly has a love for the Lord. There's no doubt about it. In verse number 1, it says, I will praise thee with my whole heart. Before the gods will I sing praise unto thee. I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth. For thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. In the day when I cried, thou answeredest me and strengthenest me with the strength in my soul. All the kings of the earth shall praise thee, O Lord, when they hear the words of thy mouth. Yea, they shall sing in the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. Though the Lord be high, yet he hath respect unto the lowly, but the proud he knoweth afar off. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, thou wilt revive me. Thou shalt stretch forth thine hand against the wrath of mine enemies, and thy right hand shall save me. The Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. Forsake not the works of thine own hands. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we open your word, we go to you, Lord, for help and instruction. Lord, we ask that the Holy Spirit will speak to us as individuals as well as the church family. And I do pray that you help us all, Lord, to, Lord, learn, to grow, Lord, to leave here different than when we walked in. And please use me as your servant to preach and teach your word and allow the Holy Spirit to move in our midst and bring across the message that each one of us needs in our own personal lives as well as our family. Father, we love you. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege and the honor to be able to be here freely today and give you praise and glory of what you deserve and help us, Lord, to be able to do more for you. Please, Lord, bless the preaching of your word here this morning and all the Sunday schools that are happening as well. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, as I read this, I think, you know, I'm one of those people, I like psychology and stuff. You guys know that if you've been here, but I like that kind of thinking what people are thinking. You know, I wish I had that gift. Amen. Well, I don't know if I'd want that. I don't even like looking at Facebook because I don't want to know what everybody's doing. But I always like to know how people, why people think the way they do, or what makes a person do the things that they do, good and bad and everything, you know. And I've thought when I read about this, I always thinking about the characters in the Bible, like David. What kind of person, what kind of personality is he? We see a lot about David in here. We see a lot about what's going inside of his heart and his mind. And I think of David as somebody that's like a sanguine personality, you know, a people person, and very bold type person. He has his extremes as well, you know. He's certainly at one minute he's high and he's praising God and saying God's going to take care of everything, but then you can see the other side where he's praying that God will kill his enemies and destroy them. And I mean, you know, we see that in his behavior and his actions sometimes. It seems like he's the closest, godliest person in the world one minute, but then there's an adultery and murder on the other side. I mean, so you see this kind of personality that's kind of like, wow. You know, and we all know it's probably somebody like that in our life that has that wow personality. And this man does great things for God. You know, he certainly, without a doubt, has a love for the Lord. And we go down through there and we read about his whole heart. He says, I will sing praise to thee with my whole heart. But he says in verse number 7, he says, though I walk in the midst of trouble, thou wilt revive me. And I think he's proven that he believes that in Scripture. David's been in some trouble in his life. He's been in some things that weren't because of what he's done, and he's been in some trouble caused because of what he did do. But in the midst of it, it seems like he always did trust in God. He always went to the Lord. And then it says in verse number 8, the Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Now that word perfect, or it means finished or completed. Finished or completed. And as we look at this, he says, thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. Forsake not the works of thine own hands. So he actually kind of puts this back on the Lord, and he says, Lord, don't forsake the works that you've created. And he's talking about himself. So he's trusting God that God will help him complete his work with what he's doing with him. You know, if you've been in church for a number of years, I'm sure you've heard messages kind of along the points of how God is working in our lives, how he's helping us and he wants us to get better each and every day. You know, that we have a calling, we have a vision that God has given us, that we need to work in our own place, in our own, ourselves as an individual, as well as our families and our churches and our communities and stuff, that we are working to fulfill God's purpose and his will for our lives, right? We all know that. That's what we are supposed to be doing. Well, David talks a lot about this in these scriptures. I want to show you another place. Look at Genesis chapter 6 with me. Genesis chapter 6. And I want you to see just another person in the scriptures real quick before we move on. But here in Genesis 6, in verse number 6 with me. Let me get there real quick. It says, "And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and creeping thing and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generations, and Noah walked with God." I know this isn't new for any of us as Christians, but we know that Noah, you know, God saw favor towards Noah because of the kind of person he was. You know, he looked down on the earth and he seen it a mess. He seen mankind at its worst. You know, I can imagine what God's thinking about today in our world. But he looks down and he sees all this, but then he kind of zeroes in on this one man, Noah. A man that is, the Bible says, perfect. A man that is just. And he looks at this world that's literally corrupt, and he says, here's a man that walks with me. That statement should tell a lot about a person. A man that walks with God. Well, what does that mean? I mean, some of you in here, I heard a couple of ladies talking yesterday about going out and running. I think Ava was one of them, and yeah, somebody, I forgot who it was, maybe Lydia or somebody, to go, you know, go running with you or something, you know, go walking. When you ask somebody to go with you somewhere, especially walking with them, usually there's some kind of a communication that happens, right? You start building a friend. You don't go walking with an enemy. You don't go walking with a stranger, usually. You shouldn't, amen? But you usually walk with a friend. You walk with somebody that you care about, you want to spend time with. And Noah was that kind of person. He was a man that walked with God, that spent time with the Lord, that was comfortable with him in conversation and behavior. And he had a relationship with him. You know, it's like, you know, think about the person that you look up to or somebody you'd like to meet in your life. And you say, oh yeah, I went and, you know, if you were talking to somebody, oh yeah, we just went for a walk yesterday together. You'd be like, what? Who? You went with them? You didn't call me? You know, you'd want to be able to have somebody you could go and just hang out with, you know, for a little while. You know, I want you to think about who these people were. What made them who they were? What made them do what they were doing? See, we know about David and his heart for the Lord. We know that he had this relationship with God that was special. We know with Noah in here that he had a relationship with God, that he was a good man. He was a moral, just man. And he had such a relationship with God that he just walked with him. It was a casual, it was something that was normal in his life. What got him to that point? You know, as a pastor, you know, my prayers often are for our people and those of our church and stuff, that each person will have a walk with God, that they'll have a relationship with the Lord, that they'll really know who God is as an individual, know when God talks to them, be comfortable of going through hard times knowing that God will get them through that, or rejoicing with him during the good times and not walking away because they get caught up in something in the world. I mean, those are the prayers you know, that I often pray for our church. But at the same time, what gets a person to that point? How does a person get there? How does a person build a relationship to where you're comfortable walking with God? You know, I want to look at something here, and it says in Genesis 17:1, I'll read this real quick. It says, "And when Abram was 90 years old and nine, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said unto him, I am the Almighty God, walk before me and be thou perfect." And I was thinking when I read that, I was like, if he's not perfect and he's 99 years old, what hope do I have?
If you think about that, 99 years old, God saying, I want you to be perfect. Abraham was a good man, amen. I mean, he walked with the Lord. He had faith and trust in God that was amazing. I mean, Abraham, you know, was certainly the father of nations. But you think 99 years old, God says, I want you to be perfect. You can't teach an old dog new tricks. Isn't that what we think of? You know, you talk about, you know, dogs. You can't teach an old dog new tricks. Some people say that just means you just really can't change at a certain point in your life. First of all, that's false. Amen. You definitely can change. And our life down here is a continual change. And it should be. Because I'll be very straightforward. All you have to do is do nothing and you're going to change. Amen. If you just don't do anything, you're going to change. And usually it's for the bad. It's for the worse. If you're just going through life and you're not really working at doing better or growing, you're probably heading backwards. You're not staying the same, usually. Now, I said all that to say this. Job chapter 1 and verse number 1 says, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright and one that feared God and eschewed evil. That means avoided evil. I want you to think for yourself for a moment here this morning. Where are you? Where are you right now with the Lord? I'm talking about today, this morning. From the moment you opened up your eyes and you woke up, how have you been this morning? What's been going through your mind? Has it been a very good day? Has it been a very bad day? I know we're only beginning, but it doesn't take long to ruin a day, right? What has been going through your mind today? Have you got up today and said, oh, great, it's church. Man, I get to go to church today. This is great. Can't wait. Oh, Lord, start singing, praising God. Has that been your mood? Or has it been, oh, today's Sunday. I got to get up and go to church. Oh, here we go. You know, where are you at? You know, just be honest with yourself, where you at. And then think about what has been the last few days of your life. How has your day gone? How's your relationships been? Have you spent the time with God that you know you should? Have you been taking time out for Him personally to where it's not a job, it's not a responsibility, it's just a walk with Him, something that you enjoy doing? You're not running, you're not jogging, which I would hate doing. We were talking about it yesterday. I don't like jogging and running. But you're enjoying the day with the Lord. You get to walk around and see the creation. And I know we're not literally doing that, but spiritually, that should be our relationship with God. You know, we read about all these people in our Bible. You know, and hopefully you're reading that daily yourself. And you read down through and you listen to, you know, how Noah was and how Job was and how David was and how Esther was and how Mary was and how Martha was. And you go through the Bible and you start looking at these people's lives. And you can either concentrate on the negative sides of who they were. There's negative on everybody in the Bible. Or the many positives that are there. But look at that hall of faith in Hebrews, where it was just a group of people that went through some difficulty, that dealt with life, that we're all dealing with today, and say, do I know God like that? Do you have that kind of trust to where if you're going through a difficult, hard time, that God's going to get you through it? Because truthfully, that's kind of uncommon, even amongst Christianity today. I don't know how many times over the years I've had people calling up in panic that something's going wrong in their life. And honestly, some can be very seriously wrong, but panicked because they think the world's falling down around them. Why? Why do we react like that if we believe God is who He is and He cares about us the way He says He cares? And that He's going to take care of us and we can trust in Him. Why would we panic, right? Now, I want to be very, you know, common sense here that we're still human. We're not perfect yet. But isn't that what we're supposed to be looking forward to and working towards being perfected? That's what I want to take the few minutes with you here today. And I want you to look at Acts chapter 10. You can turn your Bible with me. And I want to take a few minutes here this morning and talk about that. Being perfected. Being complete. You know, here in Acts chapter 10, in verse number 19, it says, "While Peter thought on the vision, the Spirit said unto him, Behold, three men seek thee. Arise therefore and get thee down and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. Then Peter went down to the men which were sent to him, unto him from Cornelius, and said, Behold, I am he whom ye seek. What is the cause wherefore ye are come? And they said, Cornelius the centurion, a just man, and one that feareth God and of good report among all the nations of the Jews, was warned from God by an holy angel to send for thee into his house and hear the words of thee." Now I want you to stop for a moment. I want you to think about this man. Here's this man, Cornelius. He's a centurion, so he's not one of the Jews at the time. He's more of the military side of things. And he says he's somebody that fears God, has a good report among all the nations of the Jews, and God is talking to him. So here we have this man that has a good reputation. A lot of the Jews like him. Everything's good. You know, he's a just man. So that means, you know, just means acting or being in conformity with what is morally upright or good. So somebody, he's a moral guy. He's a good guy. He's not a bad guy. He's not somebody that's persecuting or anybody of the Jews. He's not being unjust, treating them because of who they were. He's a good guy. God is talking with him, as the scripture says, and people like him. But he's not complete. See, we think about some of these people we talked about earlier. We were talking about what gets them there. What gets them to that place where God is using them, where they're doing great things for the Lord, where they have a comfortable relationship with God? What gets them there? Let me start off by saying this, first of all. It's not necessarily them being good. See, that is one of the big things that we often really gear in on in everybody's lives. And as a parent, you know, I'm trying to teach my kids to be good. I don't know how many times I've said that in my life, even as a parent now. Just be good. Just do right. Stop doing things that are wrong, you know. Obey what I'm telling you. It's going to be best for you. And I've said that to my children. I've said it to adults. Same type thing. And our goals oftentimes is just to be good. Now, it is good to be good. Amen? That's a good thing to do. You know, be morally sound, have convictions, have good character is something that we want all people to have. But that's not going to complete you. That's not what life is all about. There are good people going to hell. That's one of the biggest trouble people have a hard time figuring out. Well, if somebody's so good, how can they go to hell? They're a good person. I like them. They're a good person. I don't see them doing things wrong like that. Well, the truth is, goodness, true goodness, only comes from God. But God put morality into every human being. It's called a conscience. But that doesn't complete a person, perfect a person. You know, we should be working at doing good. We should be good people. God knows we need more good people in this world that have some moral character about themselves, that love people, that will go out of their way to do things for others. We need that. And there are a lot of good people like that out there. But why does God say, be perfect? Be ye perfect as I am perfect. Why did he tell Abraham at 99 years old, I want you to be perfect? In verse number 30, I don't think I gave it to these guys, but verse 30, it says, "And Cornelius said, 4 days ago I was fasting unto this hour, and at the ninth hour I prayed in my house, and behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing and said, Cornelius, thy prayer is heard, and thine alms are had in remembrance in the sight of God. Send therefore to Joppa and call hither Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lodged in the house of one Simon, a tanner by the seaside, who when he cometh shall speak unto thee." See, here's this good man that's even praying. He's religiously good. And he got the attention of God because in his heart, he wanted to know the truth. But he didn't know the truth yet. He's just a good religious man wanting to know the truth. And so God said, I will send somebody to tell you what the truth is. He wasn't complete. You know how many good religious people are in this world but aren't complete? They're missing the very thing that really matters, and that's God. People don't like hearing that sometimes. They don't like thinking that you can be good in man's eyes, but yet not complete. You can have everything that the world thinks a person should have, but yet not the very thing that matters. Just the other day, me and my wife were kind of at our house, and you know, many of you know we got a new house and stuff, and we were kind of just sitting there, and it was like a touching moment, you know, and she kind of looks up and she goes, it just feels like we've arrived. We got a beautiful home in the country we wanted. We got three beautiful children that we love and they love us. We got a beautiful church family. God's blessing the work. It just seems like, wow, so much. And I said, shh, don't say that too loudly. Isn't that what everybody was thinking? Yeah. Because it's like, you say, you admit there's something good, wait for the hammer, you know, kind of thing. But you know what, in a lot of ways, it does feel like things are very good at this point in our life. But we're both adults and we're both Christians and we know we live in this world. And we know that there's going to be trouble. There's going to be hard times. There's going to be things happening. But we also have enough trust in the Lord to know that if it happens, I have a God that's real. We have somebody that loves us and is going to walk us through this. If we have to go through a fire, he'll be there with us. That's what complete is having God with you along the way. It's not about the good things people do, because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Doesn't matter who you are, everybody's done wrong. We've all done things that are guilty of hell, because sin sends us to hell. Good works don't keep us out of it. See, here's this man, Cornelius, that was a good man. Everybody liked him. He had a good reputation. He was a religious man. He was praying, but he was missing the very thing he needed. And that was God. That's God. That's why when I talk to people, and I talk to people many times about the Lord or try and witness to them or something, many times, especially in America, people are religious. I care about God, I love God. Cornelius would say the same thing. Oh no, I believe in God and I pray every day, and that's what their religion teaches them, and that's where their conscience tells them that they need to do good and they need to, you know, trust in God. And I say, that's great, but do you have God as your Father? Is he personal to you? Is it more than just a good deed that you do because you're supposed to, it makes you feel good? See, all of us in here today, we came in here in a certain condition. You came in here maybe having a good day, maybe not having a good day. Maybe today is an unusual day for you and things are just going chaotic and crazy. Maybe. We have all different types of days. But I also want you to think, what is the normal me? Do I really have a walk with God? Do I really have a love for the Lord like David talks about? Do I really have that kind of drive to say, I want to spend time with God, and I want to go to church because I'm with fellow Christians that believe and I get to worship them there. And when I go home today, I'm not looking forward to doing something that's not right. I'm looking forward to just do something more that's right. I'm looking forward to just really building a relationship with God. See, because that's what it's really all about. That's what completes us. There's some movie I've heard about, I don't know how many times you hear that statement, you complete me. I'm not sure where it comes from, but God should complete us. Amen? Shouldn't he be the very thing that perfects us? But it's a choice. That's what I started off here this morning saying, it's a choice. In order for God to complete me, I need to be willing to allow him to do so. I want you to look at something real quick with me. 2 Chronicles chapter 8. And this is talking about Solomon. This is David's son now. And in verse number 16, it says, now all the work of Solomon was prepared under the day of the foundation of the house of the Lord. Until it was what? finished. So the house of the Lord was what? Perfected. So perfected and finished. Perfected and finished. Paul the apostle in 2 Timothy, he said, I have finished my course. He realized he was done. The Lord was going to take him home shortly. He did all the work that he was required to, that he believed the Lord told him to do with confidence. So he, when he was going to meet the Lord on his deathbed, I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. There's laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. So he says, I know I'm going to be judged, and I know I'm going to receive a reward. He wasn't doing that with arrogance or pridefulness. He was doing it with confidence. He was doing it because he knew his heart, he knew his actions, and he knew that he was doing what he was supposed to do for the Lord. We should all have that same confidence. If today we found out that we were going to have another couple days and that's it, and God was going to call us home, would you feel perfected? Would you feel like I've done what I was supposed to do? No matter the age, are you settled with saying, I believe I've done what God asked me to do for my life right now? I don't want to go see the Lord right now in my life because of my children. I'd like for them to be raised with a father. I'd like to be able to keep doing some work for the Lord here, but if God calls me home, I'd like to say I'm ready. I'd like to say I've done what I could. But you know what? Can you say, I've done what I should? I've completed my course. Can we say that? See, we talk about being perfect. Perfect just means completed. You're whole. You're finished. And we're not talking about, it's a process. But you can't finish something unless you're working on the process. It's like this. I just got finished, well, almost finished with my house. I think I'm going to be saying it for a while. I'm trying not to. Almost finished. I got some trim and stuff to put up in certain areas. But when I started my house, if I said this week I'm going to complete my kitchen, but then I started working on the bathroom, what chance do I have to finish the kitchen? Nothing, really. You don't really have much chance. So if you're not working on it, you don't even have the opportunity to complete it. And you know how many Christians today are just saying they're working at it, but they're not even on the job? Hey, Christian, we need to be actively working at completing our job for the Lord. And it takes a relationship. Why does David have that relationship with God? Honestly, because he's working at it. He's on the job. He's doing what he needs to do to build that close personal relationship where he can walk with the Lord. That Job, he's perfect and an upright and just man. He's a good man. He's doing what God has asked him to do. He says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. So that's the good part of what we're supposed to be doing. And the more you love God, the more you do right and you keep his commandments. But the more you do that, and the more you keep fulfilling his will is where you get to that point where you can walk with God with being comfortable with him. Having a relationship where it's like a no-brainer. What do you mean God talked to you today? I've had Christians say, God talked to you like that? It's like, doesn't he do to you? Why? Because it's a relationship. God wants to open up to us. He wants you to open up to him though first. Draw nigh to me, and I'll draw nigh to you, God says, right? We put so much energy into things that really don't matter. I think I talked a little bit about that last week. You know how many times people will put energy and into something that just earns them money. They'll put years into that thing. They'll put so much stress and hard time into something that really doesn't really matter in the long run. And they'll put nothing into the things that really matter. See, Cornelius worked at being a good man. He put a lot into being a good, just man. But he was neglecting the very important thing, and that was the relationship with God. 1 John chapter 2, verse number 4 says this. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Verse 5. But whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God, what? Perfected, whereby know we that we are in him. You know what he says? He says there, listen, if you don't keep his commandments, you're a liar. He just comes straight out and says it. This is what you are. You say you're a Christian, but you're not keeping his commandments, you're a liar. And then he makes it very clear. He says, whoso keepeth his word, the love of God is perfected. It's a continual growth. It's something that we work on. We're doing it. We're in that process. It says in 1 John 4:12, no man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is what? Perfected in us. So it's all about, hey, do you love other people? I know we're living in a world where everybody is against each other, where there's groups hating on each other and stuff, back and forth, all over the place. Shouldn't be amongst us as Christians. If we're going to be perfected, we got to love one another. Amen? It's the process. It's that relationship with God. For God so loved the world that he gave. Amen? That's that relationship. He's saying, listen, you can be a good person, but if you're not completing the relationship, you're missing out on everything. Last one, Psalm 138, verse number 8 says this. The Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. Forsake not the works of thine own hands. That's where we started. Think about that. He says, the Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. You know, God wants to make us whole. He wants to complete us. He wants to finish his work. Concerning me. Concerning you. Are you working with him on it? The Bible says we're laborers together with the Lord. It's a process. Amen? Let's work at that. Let's build this relationship that we all need. You want it, even if you don't quite know you want it yet. It's just like my children. I don't know how many times as young children I'm teaching them something. And I'm trying to teach them something, and it doesn't matter what it is, whether it's something to eat and food or whether it's something to do outside. And it's like my daughter, she's trying to climb this rope swing thing I made for her, and she starts climbing. She'll get up to the top, and she's a little nervous to getting up into the limb and stuff. And I'm saying, go, just keep going. You'll love it. You'll be all over the tree after a while. And then yesterday, some young men were out climbing that same tree, and she was watching them, and she was trying to climb it, right? She was, as soon as they got down, she was climbing up the rope, grabbed a hold of the limb for the first time on her own. Because she starts seeing that it can be done. You know, sometimes it is good to look around you at some other Christians and seeing what they're doing to get it done. It can be a little motivation to help you go. See where it's possible, where it can happen. There's a lot of Christians that aren't around other Christians, and so they're seeing the world and they're seeing all this other garbage out there, and they don't even think it's even possible to have a relationship with God or have God to talk to them because they're so corrupted in their ways of thinking. That's why church is so special, and it should be. Getting around other Christians that are working in the same goal and different people at different lengths and growths in the Lord, so you can see somebody and that can be encouragement for you, or you can encourage somebody else along the way, or you can keep growing in this and God's putting this person through something and now you can learn from that. It's important to perfect yourself. Doing it with God, you're not going to be perfected unless you do it with the Lord. Amen? Hey, Christian, build your relationship. I can't tell you how much you want it and how wonderful it is. I can speak till I'm blue in the face, but if you don't practice, if you don't do it, you'll never learn. Amen? It's up to you. It's up to me. We all need to be perfected. We want you just, but we really need you perfected. Amen? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you, Lord, for your help, for your instruction. Thank you, Lord, for working with us. And Lord, thank you for the examples you've given us in scriptures and the confidence some of these men had that just know that you're there for them, that you're working with them, that you're helping them to perfect their ways. And I do pray that you help all of us in here today, that each and every person in here today, Lord, that they'll work on being perfected. Lord, we need to be just. We need a just society. We need people that are doing good and being morally right, but that's not the complete part of it. It's our relationship with you. It's bringing you into the whole equation is where we get perfection, completion. Help us, Lord, to have that confidence, Lord, that we're working on the same thing with you, Lord, for your will and your cause. With every head bowed and every eye closed, let's take a few minutes out here today, Christian. Spend some time with the Lord. You can come to an altar and pray. You can sit in your seat and you can talk to the Lord. But the message here today is really getting to know God. Know him. Build that relationship. Where are you at today in relation to the Lord, in that relationship with him? Are you struggling? Is it non-existent? Is it just there and you know it's there, but it's not really doing anything? Are you going backwards? But are you going forward? We can all go forward. You can leave these doors today going forward into perfection, to a point where you're really truly arrived. You can have the confidence as the Apostle Paul in knowing that I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. I've done what the Lord has asked me to do. I'm ready. We all need that confidence. But confidence comes by truth and reality. You can't fake it to yourself. Only you and I know better. Let's take some time and talk to the Lord. If you're in here today and you're not sure of your relationship with God, maybe you're not sure if you died today, you'd have a home in heaven. Maybe you're here today and you're struggling. You don't know Jesus Christ as your own personal Lord and Savior, as your Father. While you Christians are praying, if there's somebody in here who can just be honest with themselves and say, Preacher, I'm not sure of my salvation, but I'd like to know. Would you just slip your hand up? I'd like to pray for you. I'd like to have somebody show you so you know that and get that nailed down. Anybody at all, Preacher, I'm not sure of my salvation, but I'd like to know. Let's take some time, Christian. This is for us. Let's get our relationship, get our walk, our calling perfected.
Amen. If you're done praying, let's stand to our feet. What a great sermon that was. We thank you for that, Pastor. Thank you that you came in to church this morning. Good crowd, and continue to pray for those that are on their way trying to get better, or, you know, the COVID thing starts to calm down even more. Let's close with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for being so good to us. Lord, I just... As Pastor was talking to us, Lord, stressing to us of the importance of having that relationship with you, and to continually develop that. And Lord, it's a continual process. And Lord, just help us this week as we work on our daily devotions and our prayer life, and Lord, I know I strive with that with my own life. Lord, we just thank you for what you're going to do in our lives this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Just a reminder, services on Wednesday, 7 o'clock. Have a great day. Mm-hmm.